Dan moet het zich
goed.
Ja. Oké. Very good. So welcome once again. Welcome through some bad weather to getting here. Some don't like the elevators. Already the ninth lecture. This and Friday's lecture will be about Markov models. Today I'll do the plain Markov models, and on Friday I'll do the hidden Markov models. And these arguably might be the two, I shouldn't say this, but most important lectures, because it sets you up into Bayesian statistics and conditional probabilities and all this, which will come in handy and useful, I think, later on in your careers as well. Okay, so what will we do? So you have your third practical assignment coming up this afternoon. You'll start with a new paper exercise, getting the hang of a hidden Markov model, what it is, as a general framework to model all kinds of things in a statistical rigorous way. And from tomorrow then, or anytime you please, but certainly before Friday, you'll start your programming assignment to really make your own hidden Markov model given a biological problem. You'll train that model using sets of sequences, and you'll look how well it will do, and you also will get an idea about the concept of overtraining, right? If you train models too much, they start memorizing each separate instance, and then they can't generalize anymore, and that is a problem for unseen cases of data coming. You'll get one. So there are also tomorrow, there are three main algorithms, the Viterbi, the forward, and the forward-backward algorithm, but that will come on first. Okay, so, a Markov model. I don't know who of you have ever played in a casino or something like that. If you would have read a book by Markov before you would have gone, you would have done it, because it's clear, because of Markov statistics, that the very fact that the bank account of the casino is probably a bit longer than yours, that you always have a disadvantage competing with such a guy, given the statistical framework that the casino represents. We'll do an example even about an unfair casino using unfair die or loaded die, and we'll see that, and we do that in a Markov. So we can even use Markov as a detective to track all kinds of bad things. That will be one of the examples. Anyway, a Markov chain is a general description of a sequence of events. As long as you can line them up, maybe through time, maybe through space, it doesn't really matter. As long as one event follows on the other, you can deal with that using Markov formalism. And each event, in a way, in Markov, says something about the likelihood of the next event, right? And that's certainly not always the case. For example, think about if you throw a die. Will throwing a six have an influence on the next throw? Well, if the die is from hard material, probably not so much. If it's very soft, you get sort of a dent in it, then maybe the normal die wouldn't have. So these events are independent. But okay, Markov states, and basically probabilities, so how likely is 2 after 1 and how likely 3 after 2. This is, by the way, we'll get into that, called the first order Markov, because now the memory 3 only needs to know about 2, one event back into history. But there are also Markov models that you could say, okay, now I want to go back 4 steps in history, then all these probabilities will have an influence on the occurrence of the 5th event here. Okay, so today we'll do some statistical background. I'll introduce to you what Bayesian statistics is all about. We go into Markov chain models, and then a few flavors. Depending on your situation, you could use so-called interpolated Markov models, and also Markov chain models with more memory. And then I'll give you a very brief introduction to what hidden Markov models is, so that during the afternoon, when the paper exercise comes up, you have an idea of what you could do. Right, so, independent events, something happening, an event X and an event Y. If these events are independent, you've learned probably by now, maybe several occasions, that the probabilities of each of these events is independent, you can just multiply the probabilities under the assumption of independence. Now, when things become dependent upon one another, then you talk about conditional probabilities, and you write it like this. So this you read as the conditional probability of y, so it is about the probability of y, but given x happening. Y is dependent upon x, and that's why you need to keep track of x if you want to know, find out about the probability of y. And again, if x and y are known to be independent, you know, there is not really a dependency here, so of course then, you know, if it's not really dependent upon x, py given x is just py, and vice versa. All of this can be read, by the way, in the first chapter of the introductory chapter in your Durbin book. Okay, a few more steps, then we're done. If you, the joint probability is, if there is a relationship between x and y, a dependency, then the joint probability that x and y will happen, you can write down as the chance, the probability of y given that x happens, times the probability that x happens, right? If x never happens and y is dependent upon x, then the probability will be zero, right? So you need px. And the other way around, you can do with y's first, yeah? Okay, so suppose there are all kinds of things, you know, y is sort of a probability of something, maybe a model or something happening. If you know all preconditions, then you can calculate, for example, the total probability. When you have here the joint probability, if you know all y's, all cases of y, you can all add up all of these probabilities. And also in this case, this is called the marginal probability. You need to do, and in the next example I will do about the loaded die, this probability will come up. If you have these joint probabilities and you state they're equal, px over y is the same as px y here, then you have these relationships, then you can just say this, and this is the basic formula for Bayesian statistics. And I'll put it in another form, I'll write it down in a moment, like pyx, we multiply the left and the right hand side by py, so then you get in a moment py given x equals px given y times py divided by px, but that will come up. So how do you use this model? How would you want to do this? You know, normally when you have something like this, you know, we'll talk about an example where we have in a casino, you throw with a die and all the time you lose and you think there is something wrong with the die. Your suspicion is this die is loaded. It has a much higher chance of throwing a six, getting the six up, and that means there is some lead close to the one surface, which is opposite the six. So that there is a higher likelihood that the one will be down because of the weight and the six comes out. That's an unfair die. What can you do? You can blame these guys and they say it's not true. You need to use statistics. More specifically, you need to use Markov statistics. So you're going to throw the die, and how many sixes should you throw in order to have reasonable confidence that you can start accusing these guys? You're using the wrong, incorrect die, the loaded die. So that's what we will do. And that means in this case there are two models. Model loaded die and the model unloaded die or fair die, and so you know all your models, and that is what happens here. You'll use that in the example, the sum over those two models. You'll see that in a moment. Now a bit more, and this is what I started saying. If you are on about the probability of y in the end, in our example, is the chance that the die is loaded, you can only do this through observing x, the number of throws of the number a die can emit. And you need to work with that. So it's indirectly that you work by observed data represented by x to get an idea of which y are we talking about. And that's what we're going to do now with the dishonest casino. So this is the same formula here. This was on two slides ago, right? The formula, and here I already told you, it's rewritten like this, right? This is the probability of y given x. This is in fact the probability of x given y, which you call this the likelihood that x is maximized by y. This is the prior probability, and this is this marginal probability. But I'll show you using the example. So we're going to have an example. So d loaded is y, right? This is the model. What have we got? again, you're in this casino, and here you fill in a few numbers. We know here that 1% of the die, so we know a bit more than nothing, we know that 1% of the die, it's a dishonest casino, 1% of their die will be loaded. We'll have a higher likelihood of sixes coming up. The task view is the die used in your case, when you look at the series of throws that the die has emitted, right? And the question here is, if you throw three sixes in a row, does that mean you have the loaded die, or could it still be the normal die, if you like? And of course, you know, with the normal die, you can throw five sixes in a row, you know? If, let's do an experiment, and I can tell you how the mind works. First, I will ask you, you become a die. Write up 100 numbers after another, you throw 100 times in your mind with the die, right? Right now, write down 100 numbers of 1 to 6. So you start, you say, I go throw a 3, lies you in the middle. That's how the brain works. That starts in the middle. That's our sense of probability. And then maybe a 6, because it jumps a bit, that's what we know. And then, you know, you get courageous after a while, you say another 6, after a 6, a third 6. So very courageous people among you might write down a 4th 6, but then your statistics tell you, you know, 5th 6, that's highly unlikely. So you don't do it. So you have this series of 100 numbers, 100 throws, and now you take a die and you throw the real numbers and write those down diligently as well. You do this a couple of times. It is very easy to tell the mind throws from the real throws just by, you won't do 5 sixes. And in a series of 100 throws, 5 ones or 5 twos are to be expected, almost. They happen enough. So it's easy to tell people from machines or die in this case. So here the chance, if you throw 3 sixes in a row, to what extent can you accuse the casino you gave me a wrong, a loaded die, right? So we put this in this Bayesian statistics framework. So we're talking about the model that you have a loaded die, given that you, this is Y, this is X, given that you throw 3 sixes in a row, and then the formula develops like this. That was just this one here. We do this formula now, we fill it in, 3 throws, this is the loaded die, you fill it in like this, and then you get, if you work that out, the chance for throwing 3 sixes, given that the die is loaded, times the prior probability of a loaded die. We know this prior probability, right? We know it's 1% of the die, so we know 100 is the chance to have a die, 0.01 is the chance for having a loaded die, and then therefore 0.99 is the chance for having an unloaded die, because there are only 2 models possible here, and this is this marginal probability of X throwing the 3 sixes. If you work that out, basically we know a bit more even about the loaded die. The loaded die makes that throwing a 6 has a 50% chance, half. What is the chance for a 6 in a normal die? You may guess, in a fair die, it's probably 1/6, right? All numbers are equally likely. So then you fill that in. So if you do this, this is throwing three, given that the die is loaded, so what's the chance? We know that. We know what, if the die is loaded, that the chance of throwing 3 sixes, and here you see that it's independent events, it's just 0.5 times 0.5 times 0.5, right? This is times the prior probability. We know that prior probability, that was 1%. So this is, well, that's the denominator now, and this is this marginal probability. This is the total chance of going 3 sixes. This can be done. The total chance is, if you have a loaded die, or if you have an unloaded die, how would it work out overall? Well, 1% of the die will be loaded, so your 3 sixes will occur with a chance of half to the power 3. 99%, 0.99 of your fraction of die will be unloaded, will be fair, and then you throw a 6 of each, like 1/6 to the power 3. If you work this out, throwing 3 sixes gives you a posterior probability, given this prior probability, because this is in the end the posterior probability that you have that the loaded die, and this was your prior probability, the thing you guessed or thought you knew beforehand. And this is what comes out. Look at the difference. This was 1%, and you get a 0.21. I don't know if you would accuse very bitterly of the statistics, but this is 22 times higher than 0.1. So your 3 sixes, throwing the 3 sixes, certainly add to the likelihood, the posterior likelihood you learn from your data, and now you say, oh, I thought before it was 1% chance, but now I think it's 0.21. Not enough maybe to say you filthy and so on. So then you say, okay, throw another, and you throw 4 6, right? And now you see, if you just do this with the 4 sixes and with the 5, then your chances become 0.45 and 0.71. I think at this stage, you walk to this guy and say, I beg your pardon. I think you're doing bad things here, right? So this is, by the way, also explained in Durban Knowledge, this framework, okay, you can just read it. So what's interesting, Bayesian statistics, is about if you have some preconceived knowledge, then you can use it in this framework. You have observed data, you use that data, you use the preconceived knowledge, and you get a so-called posterior probability. And in, I can already tell you, in training, you hit a Markov model. If you do this iteratively, you get something nice, because then you say, if we do this at one other time, maybe we have more data, we use the data again, then we could call this posterior probability prior, and then you do this once again. And you can learn, all the time learn on with your posterior probabilities. Iteratively. That will happen in your assignment, but that is for later. Now, this framework is for discrete steps, right? You have discrete models, the loaded die, the unloaded die. Mathematicians, of course, like to go to the continuous framework, and very many times parameters are continuous measurements, length, time, it's all continuous. So then the exact same formulas happen. This is the exact same thing. This is now this sum, this marginal probability, but it's now more like an integral, because you have to add up continuous variables. You do this in mathematics using integrals rather than summation. And so here it is, the integral of your marginal probability. So it works exactly the same. And if you want to know more about it, Durbin is having a bit more information. But for us, we will stay in the discrete case, okay? Now, some further issues is, so we talk about the prior probability of something and the posterior probability of that same model or event, given that you learn from the prior and the data. Very often, you go in the casino, and you have an inkling like, there might be loaded die, and then how many as a prior do you do? You might say, I don't know, let's put something safe, half the die. Or you think, no, they can't possibly do it. It's maybe wrong. So you sometimes you have a good reason to know how to fill the prior, sometimes you don't, and then you could just take measures equally. We have 6 models, I don't know, so they all have a chance 1/6. I can already start. And then if you do it iteratively, if you get it posterior, you can do it again and sort of also learn by doing what your prior might have been. So all of these things happen. So here, this one statement, you know, if you don't know the true prior probability, you can start guessing. And if you have enough data, then still things will be all right. Because both your prior probabilities and your data will inform your posterior probability. Now, You've seen this formula, so prior and likelihoods are all multiplied. So sometimes this is about the distribution of your prior, of your probability or events, and sometimes the mathematicians like to use nice words. If this distribution is the same, so if the distribution of the priors is sort of the same distribution, doesn't mean the same numbers, but it's the same, you know, normal distribution or whatever you have, all kinds of distributions, then you mathematicians call those distributions conjugate. Meaning, you know, they're of the same type. And here you see a few binomial, the beta distribution, multinomial, really can be used in bioinformatics as well. So if they're the same in the prior and the posterior, you call this conjugate. Okay, but of course, although you can learn from having lots of data, of course, having good information on your prior is still important, right? And that is what you would typically do if you don't know the prior, you start using a couple of guesses. You start with a number of priors and then see what happens, right? That's what you always can do, of course. Okay, let's, you like networks, I believe, I hope so, if you're in bioinformatics and or systems biology. So I show you a network of one of the simpler Markov models. Here we go. So what's a Markov model? There are basically two entity states. These are the squares here, well, square, something edgy. And transition probability, substates and transitions. The arrows represent transitions, and each transition represents a probability, the likelihood of the transition. So being in state G, you have apparently a 0.12 likelihood that the next symbol, in this case probably in your DNA sequence, it's not through time, it's through the sequence you're ordering now, is a T here, right? So you see here in orange all the likelihoods getting out of the state G. You see that? So they probably should add up to 1. I never added it up. Is anybody quick here? You can start shouting if it's not 1. I hope it's 1.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Very good. Okay. So that's the idea, of course, because statistics should fit right. It should add up to 1. Because that is, of course, the chance of getting out should be 1 in the Markov model. And here you see just the probabilistic framework again. The likelihood of observing symbol A, given that one step earlier, this is in sequence position I, given that in sequence position I minus 1, one event earlier, one residue earlier, if you like, one nucleotide earlier in this case, the chance is 0.16, so we're just talking here about this probability, right? The likelihood of A, given that you had G before, yeah? This is how you take it. So these are, again, these yellowy numbers, same thing, yeah? Okay, so how can we start running a Markov model? And you can already see there's one sort of special state here. That's this begin state. So you enforce it, you have to start here. So there can be a transition. This transition, you see here that out of the begin state, you can basically go to any letter, meaning that your nucleotide sequences can start with any letter. Suppose it would be like in proteins, you would have proteins, we know. The protein comes off the ribosome. What's the first letter by definition? An M, methionine, right? Because the start codon, remember, codes for methionine. Then all kinds of stuff happens, so mature proteins can start with any symbol. But if you want to model only an M, then you would, of course, have only one sort of arrow from the begin state to a given letter in the sequence. So you can play with that model if you have more of this state. This state is also called a silent state. Why? Because executing your model, it does not emit a symbol. Basically, if you feed it the sequence 4 A's in a row, A, what will happen, you think? So, start here, you have to, then where do you go? You see an A in the sequence, so you need to go to that state. You have this probability. Where do you need to go to observe the second A? Once again, and once again. So that means your total probability will be this arrow times this arrow times this arrow times this arrow. The probabilities are nice, of course, right? But okay, that's how you work with it. So basically, first ingredients, the Markov chain model is defined by set of states, squares in the begin state, and some states emit symbols like the square states in the begin state, in this case, doesn't emit. You start, but you don't. It's not a symbol, you're before the sequence, so to speak, and then you go in. And you need a set of transitions, yeah? These are the transitions, of course, going out of one state into a possible next state. You sometimes see that not all transitions are there. I don't even know if that is the problem here. They're all there. You can make models when some arrows are missing and then they're just zero, right? You can make an error, put zero or say, well, then it becomes nicer to see if I don't see the arrows, meaning they're zero. Chance is zero, so it won't happen. How many possible transitions are there? How many arrows have you got? And that's just a full matrix. If you have your states, you have a full n by n matrix. You have the going back arrows on the main diagonal in the one direction between A and B on the one side, the triangle of the matrix and the other triangle. So an n by n transition matrix gives you a place for each of the transitions, right? Full matrix. So that means, if we start, we have a set of states, a sequence of states. In this case, there were just 5 states, the begin state, and 4 emitting states, 4 symbol states. And you have your transition matrix. This defines your, and what you need to really be able to do something with this Markov model. You need to have a sequence, something that happens, that you can calculate the probability of. And you also need an initial probability of the states. You need to know how likely is each of the states initially. Okay, but examples will make that clear. Now, if we do this, then we can start calculating. How do we calculate probabilities? I already started saying a bit about that. So what we have, if we have a Markov model with parameters, you can ask the question, how likely is a given sequence? So you have this Markov model with your states and transition probabilities, and now you give it some sequence. I gave you the example of 4 A's. could be any sequence, and then you could write the probability of, given a Markov model, seeing this series of events, x1 till xl, so the sequence now runs from here, from right to left, you can say, okay, that means all the time that, you know, how likely is the last letter in the sequence, that is dependent upon the occurrence of all earlier letters in the sequence. You see that here? The last letter is L, so here it's dependent upon the likelihood of L minus 1, L minus 2, L minus 3, the whole thing, yeah? Times, and here you see this probability, times the probability of L minus 1, because these events are, well, you multiply it because they're at a higher sense independent, but the tendencies are in the history, L minus 1, and you see here the same thing, L minus 2, till x1. All the way down until you have the first symbol. The first symbol in the sequence doesn't have anything before, of course. It's the first one, so that's just this probability. Now, a key property of most Markov models is that they use the so-called first order, and that means to know, and you saw already a model doing that, to know the likelihood of L, I don't care about deep history, I only want to know the likelihood of the symbol before, L minus 1. If you do that, you can rewrite this formula into something a little bit simpler. The probability of XL, which is here now, dependent upon all earlier ones here, you now say, okay, for the likelihood of L is only dependent upon the likelihood of X, and then the transition probability into L. Same here, one before in the sequence L minus 1 is only dependent upon one before that, and so on and so forth. Yeah? Same thing, but here you convert all this history to so-called first order. The history here is means only one sequence symbol before the letter you're interested in. Yeah? And this is this, and if you ask a mathematician how to write this, this is this multiplication sign. It is now this one goes here, and then here you have this counter I equals 2 to L, because your 1 is here, of all these probabilities. Yeah? Same, this is exactly the same as this. Okay, so this is how you evaluate Markov chain models. And it might be that, now, tell me, if this pathway is taken, about what sequence are we talking? It's not too difficult, right? The yellow one, or the orange one. Begin, first letter in the sequence we see is apparently a C, if this pathway is taken. Then we go to G, then apparently we go back into G, and then we have a T, and that's it. So our sequence that is emitted by this pathway, you know exactly how the pathway goes, you know exactly go through this state first, then through that state, comes back into the state, and then till the end. You know the sequence. What's the likelihood of this sequence? So what's the likelihood of the letter T, given a first order Markov model? That's here. The likelihood for T is the same, is dependent upon the likelihood of G and the transition probability, this transition probability. The likelihood of G, the second G, is dependent upon the first G before that time, and so on and so forth, back to the first. And C is the first in the sequence, so there is nothing before it. So it's just the probability of C, right?
Is it the probability that C is the starting entry
of
the sequence?
It's just this probability here in this state, from the beginning state.
Okay, so it's not the total probability of
no,
C
it's not
in
the.
Because that would be.
Yeah,
inaccurate.
You could see it. No, you might see it, the total probability. But it's the first, right?
Hmm.
Of that first. So this won't happen. This cannot happen.
So in your training sets, there could be lots of C's, but none in the beginning. Then
that could be.
Yeah.
If your begin state wouldn't go to C.
In that case, the PC would be zero.
Right, would be zero.
Yeah.
So your likelihood of that sequence would be zero, because the Markov model tells you no sequence can start with C.
Exactly.
If you get it, give it such a sequence, okay, you get zero, right? So it works. Okay, one extra thing, if you want to play more with Markov models, and also in hidden Markov models, you will have these extra type of states. You can make a begin state. If you make a begin state, it's also fair when you could make an end state. Yeah? So here you can sort of specify, you're only allowed to start with A at the beginning, and here you could specify you're only allowed to start end with G at the end of the sequence. So you get a more flexible framework. So this is basically what happens in practice with most models. They have a begin state and an end state. Both of these states are silent. They don't represent a symbol of the sequence. Okay? you get really a symbol. So if you walk like this, then you know, if you go here, then you say, okay, that's A. And then we go to C, and then to T, and then to A, and then to C, and then to G, and so on. You get all these probabilities. But then if you go through a stage, you emit a symbol. The symbol, of course, that corresponds to the stuff. So that is why if you feed it different sequences, the pathway taken through your hidden Markov model can be quite different, right? If the sequence is different, your pathway will be different. Yeah, question.
Doesn't this kind of modification where we add the arrows from each letter to the end make sure the sequences have higher probability?
You could, absolutely. If you would, for example, only have an orange arrow here.
Yeah.
So that probably would be one then, right, going to the end state.
Because we don't have to multiply all this.
So then, you know, all probabilities here will be zero. So that means you can never go, sequences that end with a G, C, or T will get the probability zero.
Yeah.
Only the ones with an A will have a probability of one for this last chance. But depending on all the earlier arrows you go through, right,
mm-hmm.
that's your likelihood. Yeah.
But for example, if we have like a sequence that only consists of A,
yep.
and we like test it on this model,
yep.
so we get a higher probability for this sequence than a sequence, say, that consists of A, G, C, T.
That depends upon all these probabilities. You know, if this probability is high, 0.9,
right.
Yeah, then A, but if this probability is 0.001, then you're on the second A, you have to multiply. Yeah, so all the time we multiply numbers below 1, right? In between 0 and 1. So the final likelihoods are normally quite low, eh? And computers run the risk again that, you know, they can't tell the difference from a very small number and 0, and all of these problems we've discussed before may happen here as well. In your exercise, you won't bother with this because this data set is small enough. Another question.
What if you want the start of the sequence to always be ATG? If you apply the multiple starts.
So always ATG?
Yeah.
Well, for this model, you might be, but then, you know, if you want that always, that means if you have to go only to this A with a likelihood of 1, then you go with a likelihood of 1 to T. The likelihood of 1 to, what did you say, G, but then after that you need, of course,
also another,
and now you've given away too much for these three first guys, so you have a problem a little bit. So if you would, then you would make a high probability, but then you would distinguish, later on you'll see, you distinguish the first bit and put that in different states to describe that, right? This model is too simple to do those kind of sorry, another question I didn't hear quite right.
I'm suggesting, can we make this depend on the position?
Make it depend on position. Very good. Hold that thought for a moment. Here, there is not like, initially you say, where the letters occur, we don't care. Right? This probability happens if A is, this probability happens if A is in position 10 or in position 1000. Doesn't matter. Of course, you can distinguish if you want. So I'll give you some examples where you see that you can refine models and keep track of more complicated things, right? Okay, so basically, what have you got? If you have a sequence, that sequence will take a given pathway, you know, corresponding pathway through the model, and you just multiply all the arrows, if you like, you walk through. That's what you do. Yeah. Like I tell it now, you need to know the probabilities. All probabilities should be known before you can run it.
So it doesn't change when
you need to train the model first. Before you use it, you need to know the probabilities.
Whatever it makes a single.
So you have a model, you train your model, you have a knife, you sharpen your knife, training, then you start cutting, right? So you have a Markov model, you make a Markov model, you make the architecture, you know, what network, how many states, that's what you make, how many arrows, you know, big, small, this is a very small model. We have huge Markov models with very many states, very many transitions, very many parameters to train. But that's what you have to do before you can use it to say, given this model, how likely is my sequence, or questions like that, you need your parameters. Yes, so the first step, and we'll do that on Friday, is training the model.
Okay.
And for training, you need a set of data of sequences. In this case, you know about. You know, you're modeling something, right? You need to know about that something in your sequence. You train gene prediction. Then you train, then you need, that will come up, then you need sequence where you know the genes, where they are, and then you can train, right? Okay, so that will come. So basically, it's just the multiplication, sorry, I can't get to the word for a moment, of all of these transition probabilities. So, again, formally, this is an arrow from state, the likelihood given state I given the earlier symbol I minus 1, this is transition probability, and in most Markov formalisms it's called A. A stands for transition probability. Yeah? And again, here, this is again, you have a sequence of n symbols, x1 to xn. This is the begin state, right? From the begin state to that first letter, this probability, and then from 2 to L, you calculate all the other transition probabilities. So this is just the same as I just told you. Yeah? And BX1, this one, is this probability, is from the begin state to the first symbol in the sequence, right? So that's just this arrow in the figure. One of these arrows. Yeah? That probability. So all the probabilities and then all the transitions that you use, that you go through when you thread, if you like, your sequence through the model. Yeah? So the letters in your sequence dictate where you go in this model, right? If it's an A, you have to go to the A state. If then the T follows, you have to go to the T state. And therefore you get these transition probabilities. Okay, so what's here the Markov model? States, transition probabilities. I'll show you a picture because that says more than 1,000 words, so we do it a bit different. Here we are. This is a so-called hidden Markov model. Now, nothing is hidden, eh? Not according to this essential bioinformatics textbook. What's the difference? We have a begin state, you have transition probabilities, just like that. What's the difference, guys? Instead of a single letter that is emitted for 100% by that state, there was an A here, I think, a moment ago. Now, the model says, you know what? I'm not sure what letter I'm going to emit. You know. There are four letters in the alphabet, if you talk about DNA. So this is your distribution of the likelihood of the letter given that you're in this state. Yeah, and this adds up to 1, I hope, for each of the boxes. So here you can see that the A is a bit more likely than the others. Here you can see that this one likes C and G a bit more. This one likes A and T more than the others and so on. Huh? So different states. States are different because they have each a different distribution of the four likelihoods in this case. What is hidden? I just said nothing is hidden. If I give you the sequence AAA, how could that run through this model? I can tell you. Go in here. Done. Tell you something else. I like another pathway, right? How is this? I go here, and then I go there, and I do one time like this, and then out. Ah, by the way, I'm cheating. It is an end state. We do it again. I'm sorry. A, I made an error. I do the first. A, I go back into A. Then I go here, take this A, and then out. I have to go out, and we can only get out via this state, via state 3 or state 4, right? So whatever. I could also go like this. Why not? I could also do here, and then here, go back here, and then to the end. I could also go here. Here, and then here, and out, 3 A's. So that means there's now not a single pathway possible. There are very many pathways possible. That's the hidden aspect. You don't know which pathway is being taken. You had a question?
How do you determine that there are different states?
Again, now we have even more parameters. We have states, we have transition probabilities, all these arrows, and now we have a big set of even more, and these transitions are called, will come emission. Yeah, the emitted letter, the letter emitted by the state. So here, you don't have a single letter that will be emitted, such as in Markov models. Hidden Markov means you have a distribution of them. But you need to train them, you need to know them before you can do it. right? Now,
So what exactly do these states, what are they, or like, because in the previous model, it looked like it was like one state is a position of a position one in the DNA.
One state is here as well, a position in your sequence. But the pathway corresponds to a sequence. Suppose that we will do this, we'll make a Markov model for gene prediction. So we want to find out, you know, we have globin genes, and we have a whole set of globin gene sequences, and we think, you know what, I would like to find, much better than BLAST can do it, I would like to find more family members from all of these sequencing projects. I'll build a Markov model for gene sequences. Topology, think that's what you'd like to do. You train it, given the sequence you know are globin genes, and you have to train it, and then the idea is then you load new sequences in the model, and hopefully if it's really a globin sequence, that the Markov model says, yes, high likelihood. And if it's something else, low likelihood. And that's how you would use it. So the pathway is your full sequence, but you're right, each state is a single letter in your sequence. Yeah? And then you go to the next letter, to the next letter. Yeah? Okay, here's an example of that fact, of various pathways. And now we're at it, we calculate the probability. Suppose you would like to calculate the likelihood of sequence AAC, given this pathway. You see the little numbers here? So you have the pathway 0, of course you start at the begin state, and then you go to 1, and then to 1 again, and then to 3, and then to 5. Let's do it. What does that mean? AAC, is this correct? Could this happen? You first go in the, from 0 to 1, the first letter A. Likelihood of 0.4. Then we go again via this arrow times 0.2, transition probability, into the A of coming in this state again, times 0.4. Then you apparently have to go to state 3. Which letter should you emit now? We have had two A's, so that should be the C. The C, that's C here, and then out. Before, in a Markov model, you just calculated all the transition probabilities, but now you also put in this multiplication emission likelihoods. Okay? So that's why you know that this transition probability times this emission probability times this transition probability times again the A as an emission probability times the transition probability going to state 3, we're here now, times the emission probability C, the third letter, the last letter in the sequence, times the transition probability of going from 3 to the end state, done. That's if you walk this way. Here I just put some other possibilities. Suppose you want to do this. 1 and then 3, 3, and then out. And first we swallow here, now you do it here one time and again. Gives the same probability, apparently. But another way, going down here, so what do we do here, 2, 2, 4, 5, so we go A, back into A, C, out, has a higher probability, you see that? This pathway is more likely than that. Okay, so.
I thought you just said it's still here, each state represented the position in the sequence,
yeah?
But in this example, for instance, you skip position 2 and 4 then altogether. So I still don't see what...
You're not forced to use to go through all states.
But if... So 2 does not represent position 2 in a sequence. So
which 2?
The 2...
No,
the
no, no, not the states.
Oh.
Look, here. If you walk the orange pathway, the first letter goes to state 1. Then for the second letter, we go back in state 1.
Mm-hmm.
So second letter in the sequence, first state in the model.
Yeah.
Yeah? Then we go to state 3 for letter 3. Okay, but I could have called this one 4 and this one, you know. So yeah, there is a series of states, and there is a series of sequence symbols that is not the same.
Then what is state then?
Sorry?
What does state represent then?
State represents a part of your hidden Markov model that will correspond to a number of, possibly to a number of symbols in the sequence. Here, this orange pathway, you walk through begin, through this state two times, this state one time and out. We don't even use this. This is a model. A model bears knowledge about the thing you want to model. Yeah? And it doesn't mean that you need to go through all states, depending on your sequence and depending on your model. It might happen. The model we had a moment ago, Markov model with A, C, T, G states, the moment you feed in the sequence that has these four letters, you're sure you have to go through all these four states, right? No other way. Here, not necessarily, because you have these transition probabilities. Yeah?
Okay, and what is the difference between, like, is emission is when we, for example, we have A and A, and transition is, I don't understand the difference between emission and
transition. So, the transition means the likelihood of going from one state, state one, to state three.
And how do you know that?
You have to train it. We'll get to that, how you know them. The numbers we don't talk about, they come.
No, I mean, like, how do I know that I have to, like, go from one state to the other? When the two letters are different? Or?
No, this is independent. So, whatever happens, whatever letter is here, whatever letter is there, your transition probability is 0.8, going from 1 to 3. Here, yeah? What letter you pick in each of the states here, that is this emission probability. Okay? Maybe the next question, then maybe that becomes clearer. You had a question?
No,
is it gone?
Yeah.
Evaporated, good? That could be. We'll go in models like that. Yep. Yep.
You could, of course, maybe get the sequence AAA by going one time in the first state and two times in the third state, or two times in the first state and one time.
Yeah,
in the
this one is here.
So do you always choose like the maximum score?
That's a very good question. Mm-hmm. There are two or three basic algorithms. There are two questions you can ask. We're going too fast now. One question is, what is the likelihood of the best pathway? What's the highest scoring pathway? Because you see, the scores can be different of a pathway for a sequence. What's the best one? But if you ask the question, and now I'm going a bit too fast, but we'll call it Friday again then, what is the total likelihood of a sequence, AAC, given this model? Then you have to add up all probabilities of all possible pathways. Yeah? And then I say immediately, good luck with that. Because in the big model, so this looks like, ooh, how can this ever happen? You need to. But there is a very clever algorithm you've seen already that will be used for this. But anyway, they will come. Okay, so at this level, I think I didn't answer your questions completely, but that is more like, I would say if you go into the practical, so I'll try one more time, right? Each probability here in this model, as you can see, is not conditional upon the type of letter. So from this state to that state will always be 0.2. Yeah? Here, depending on, so you basically can pick, for, you know, if I go in this state and I have the letter A in my sequence, I know that I should pick this transition, this emission probability. If it's a G, I will take that one. Yeah? So the moment I have a letter and I go to a state, then it's clear what you should do. Right? And how you set all these numbers, that will come later, that's training. Okay? So this is a big job to train a big hidden Markov model, because there are many probabilities you should know. That's a big issue. Okay, so basically, I'll gloss over it for now. This is the same formula as I had a moment ago for Markov models. The only difference is you see these E probabilities, and these are for the emission probabilities. Yeah? The A probabilities are transitions from now on, and E probabilities are emission probabilities. Yeah? Once again, emissions being the emission of a letter with a probability, and these arrows are the transition probabilities. Okay? So that's once again here the Durbin, sorry. This one that you'll find in the Durbin book is the exact same thing. Look here. This is all your pathways. Zero is typically the begin state. If you have the state is index zero is the begin state, so your sequence starts with one. It's okay. So this is a state, the pathway, a given pathway. Here it ends with zero, so it starts with zero and ends with n. And here Durbin says, okay, given a given pathway, I just call like this, right? And so you see it's exactly the same thing. Okay, this is it. linear physics. This is the other way. This is, you know, the path spelled out over the steps, and this is, you call it that path.
Okay, let's go into an example. Back to Markov models for now. So no emission probabilities for the time being, only transition probabilities. And we'll do something that is biological. CPG islands, they're called. Sounds cool, right? CPG stands just for, it's always confusing, I think, but so it's just CG in the sequence. CPG means, okay. This is a CG, okay? And if you have many of these CGs, and why is the P there? Because if you say CG, a lot of people might think this, you know, you have a DNA sequence and there is the Watson-Crick base pairing, C opposite G, right? So people thought that that would be confusing. So they say CPG means just a C followed by a G in the sequence. I think that's even more confusing, but I leave that to you. So CPG means, so what about them? Well, there is some biology about that, and that is that the C in a CG, a C followed by a G, that C for some reason has a higher likelihood of becoming methylated. That is the addition of a biochemical group, and that has important consequences for DNA. DNA methylation is an important thing. You see that some species have it, humans have it. Yeast, for example, does not have methylation. So it's important for epigenomic activity, how you use the genes, gene expression, for example, is on the influence of methylation. So a C and a G has a high likelihood of being methylated. And then what happens as a next step, if you have such a methylated C, and I'll show you the chemistry in a moment, then there is a high likelihood again that this C will be changed into a T. So your DNA letter is changed. So is that a good idea? If it's just a stretch in DNA, that's unimportant. But if you're in a gene, maybe just changing a C to a T might have dire consequences. So you have to be careful with that in gene regions, right? And that's so. And another thing is that methylation normally leads to underexpression of a gene region. So if you have a stretch that is a gene that is used, if that is methylated, usage of that is normally diminished. And in most cases, that's not such a good idea because genes are there for a reason. Maybe in some cases, it's good not having so much of the stuff. But typically, that's not good. And that is why in genes, you have something going against methylating CG pairs in genes. Okay? Methylation is this. It's an enzyme that's called M5C methyltransferase. This is the group where it happens, so methyl group that's here, CH3 will be added to here. And this is the position 5 sugar ring, they number it like this. So this is called the C5 here, that's where it's, and here, here. So, that one is specifically methylated by this enzyme. Yeah? That's the biochemistry. And now there's a bit of epigenetics here, because here you have a parent cell, I should say, which has a methylated C in this CG pair. Very often you find opposite, in the opposite strand, of if you have CG in one direction, you get GC in the other direction, right? No other way, because there's a Watson-Crick is C opposite G, and vice versa. So if you have CG in this direction, there is also CG in the other direction, in the complementary strand. So if this cell is going to divide, you get a blue copy in one cell, and the other copy, the opposite strand in the other cell, and then these are sort of replenished with red. So what have you got? Because this one is methylated and this one is methylated. The new strand doesn't have a methyl group here, but that is sensed, what you see in these cells. If there is one here, if that one was methylated, if methylation step takes place, it says, hey, I see a methyl group there. Let's say I want to make one opposite. You see another CG pair in the, that's here, you see this one? That's not methylated. Since it's not methylated, methylation will not take place in this one because it doesn't sense a methyl group. Yeah? You need one methyl group in the other one. Okay? So that means, in fact, that where there is, this will be carried on in next generations of cells. Okay? Methylation inherits, if you like, in other cells. All right? And this is called an epigenomic phenomenon, yeah, these type of things. Because it basically has nothing to do with the DNA letter per se. It is something that happens because of circumstances, situations, and then something happens to this letter. But for example, this C is the same C as that one. It happens because of other reasons, not by inherent reasons, reasons of the DNA molecule. Okay? So, how does this have a bearing? Because I'm all about to make a program that can predict gene regions in genes. That's what we want to know. How can we use this? Well, from all this derives a simple fact that here, that methylation is suppressed around genes in the genome, and that is why, because it's suppressed, you have a higher likelihood that CG islands appear more frequently close to gene regions, certainly upstream. And that's why they are called CPG islands. So before a gene, you get a bunch of CG, CG, CG easily, because there is no methylation there, so nothing goes wrong if it happens. But since that is the case for very many genes, you can use that as a signal to say, if I see a bunch of CG, CG, it's likely the gene is following. So we use that for gene prediction, right? So if you want to do this, then a Markov chain can be a good idea. And now we make it even more statistical. I've often told you that if it's the moment you talk to a statistician, such a person will tell you, you need a null model. You need your model, you need your null model. Remember, Dayhoff and Blossom, you've got your model, but you need a null model. What's the probability of the frequencies. So we'll make those models here. So first what we need to do is we need these likelihoods, and that means we need some priors and things like that. So here we're going to do, so we need a data, we need a model. The model is signified by this Greek letter, and here you have the data is represented by D. So first we want to find out what is the likelihood of the data given a model. So this is called maximum likelihood. If you maximize this, the likelihood of the data given a model, this is this conditional probability again, then we should have coffee for a long while, right? Okay. I'll finish the next one, then you can think about that and then you check up the coffee. Okay, so what are we going to do? And what is maximum likelihood? It's very simple. Suppose here we have three input sequences. And we would like to get a sense of what's the likelihood of A, what's the likelihood of C, and so on, given these sequences. These are the input sequences we want to learn from. How are we going to do this? And this thing comes very simple. You just count the number of A's. Apparently there are six in these three sequences. And these sequences are 10 long, so you have 30 positions overall. So 6 out of 30 is 0.2. So you just take the frequency, and that really maximizes the likelihood given the sequences. Why did you find them? It might be that one sequence has more A's than the other, but you say if this is representative of the situation, then I take the sequences as having the same conditions, and that's why I maximize my likelihood of seeing an A. So that's maximum likelihood. Now, I send you to coffee with this nasty feel. What if we have an input data set that's like this? A few changes. Just the six A's are now changed into G. Well, how will our counts look like this? Would you like this in your model? No likelihood for A anymore. You could say, well, that's what this sequence set tells us. But of course, you get this nasty feel like, yeah, what if I would have a bit more? Is this really true for this family? What if I would have had three more sequences for this family? Would I have gotten A? And if the answer you think is yes, then you have to do something. You remember how this was called? Very good. After the coffee.
I mean, if you're not going to eat it, I'll eat it.
Go ahead.
Omar, do you want to do this? Obama.
Neon
Obama.
Cancer stuff. It's actually really good.
Yeah.
I don't know what's happening. I'd be king of the world if I could just like make people care.
That's like
So for some who would like to have some fun, have a look of at a exam question in the past to give you. Except altijd exams. I always put exams on older exams on Canvas, so I'll do that. So you see this one as well.
And then everyone like does it for the day.
So what kind of sequence can you express with this simple model? Only x, right? So it can be sequence x or sequence xx or sequence xxx of all possible sequences, as long as it's x, right? So but what happens with the probability of longer sequences? This is remarkable. What's the probability of seeing sequence x? 1, 9, 0.9. Not so bad. What's xx? 1 times 0.1 times 0.9. It's 10 times lower. What's the probability of seeing xxx? 10 times lower. Right? So, when is this total probability 1, you think? So we write down x was what was the probability you said? 0.9, right? xx
number? What was that? 0.09, right? XXX. 0.009, right? When will this go to 1, you think? Look at the numbers. Sorry. Yeah? So you get 0.009. So how will this go to 1? Ah, yes. According to a mathematician, it will. If you have all sequences infinite length, then you go to 1. Yeah? That's the limit case. But here you can see this model apparently says okay, the likelihood of this is a gene sequence of longer sequences is less likely that it has that function or anything, right? Because they become a lot lower. At a certain point in time, you might say if you draw the line at 0.5, oh, don't do this because then you have already this, whatever. But you say I don't trust this anymore, okay? So how could you change your model then if you would say I would like to bias longer sequences a bit more? Can you, what could you do? Slight suggestion, what if you would switch those two numbers? What happens? Try it. What is the chance of X? So now you have to think that this is 0.9, now this is 0.1, okay? Okay? So, what now? Sequence X, please. What's the chance?
0.1.
Is it 0.1? Okay. Sequence XX?
Yeah.
Is that difficult? 1 times, 0.9 times 0.9. That's difficult, of course. No, sorry. XX is
0.9.
It's still 0.09, right? We should be better if calculated from that distance value. Okay, XXX.
0.81. Yeah.
Okay. So it drops off more slowly.
Yeah.
So your bias against longer sequences is less now. Now just a simple example, you know, how you can influence with parameterizing your Markov model. What you see. Very simple case, right? But okay. And now you think in Markov models of 10,000 states. Zillion transition probabilities, you know. Begin and end state, all kinds of silent states in the middle because, you know, sometimes you go from one domain to another, you would like to, you know, you can make it as complicated as I don't know what, right? That's, so it's a rich toolkit. But did you see this or not enough? Or
yeah, so I just had another question. How did we, from that complicated ratio, start from reasons that is complicated? What is missing? Because, okay, this is already calculated, so we have the problem, so it's a bit, but where is the thing that was under?
To get these parameters, you need to train your model. So I'll tell you next time, one way out of many possibilities, is one widely used way for training your parameters. Basically, I'm going to talk you into it because we're starting with data to train the model. Go on. Setting up your model, pulling the boxes and the arrows, you know how you, that is, it's not yet a computer program, maybe some help, but that is basically done by good thinking.
How can you do that in the case of
a simple platform?
It depends on what
it's. Okay.
How's the high jump thing going?
you decide.
You'll do an example of
the
I
join it,
but
state has all
the
benefits
that
makes it.
So depending on what you want to model.
Die heb ik bij me, die heb ik bij me. Kunnen we wat aan doen? Goed punt. Dankjewel. Alsjeblieft. Nee. Ik had me dan wel ingedaan aan de andere kant, maar dat helpt nog wel. De camera staat nog steeds gericht op het scherm. Hey, hij interfereert.
Yeah.
I see the screen. Ah, that's interesting. Is that, did that happen? I don't know.
Here,
very interesting, right?
Different from here. Then
you need to do this.
Oh. But I'm not sure why.
Why is it interfering? Ah, because I see why. I think
it's a fractal.
Did
you
see
that? No, it's because it's recording.
No.
Yeah, because it's recording itself.
It's recording the screen.
We can put it to the side.
Okay.
It's a fractal, huh?
Yeah. This is, yeah. So we shouldn't do anything.
We can do electro fractals. It's not an actual fractal. It's limited by the resolution of it. Of course, but. Describe it.
When it's not a continuous function, it's discrete.
Okay, so. I think this, we discussed this already. Pseudo counts with blah, so I can be brief, I guess. So we had a sequence with letters A before. So then these are your frequencies. If you really calculate the frequencies you get out of these three sequences without having a letter A, you would get zero for the probability of observing the letter A, which is probably not a good idea. So you go to pseudo counts, as was already suggested. And so in a simple way, you could say, you know, four letters, I gave each, I hear somebody talking, you will be recorded for eternity. Do you want that? Recording is on, right? Everybody will know that you talk through this lecture forever. Okay. So you give it 1 point per letter, and that means that, you know, the A gets one, so it's boosted by one. And then, you know, because you have 30 letters in the sequence, each get one, you have a total of 34 now. A, C, T, and G get each a point straight off. And that means that now your probability of this pseudo count will become 1 over 34. And the C had 9 on its own will also get an extra 1 over 34 as well. This is a little bit more elaborate way of doing pseudo counts. Sorry, not this one, this is the simple one. This one, where you can sort of mix it in, you know, here I said I give it 1 point. What if I say I give it 5 points initially? So that is what you can see here. So for example here, if you say each of the letters as a prior probability, I think, are equally likely. That's what you said a moment ago as well. You fill in 0.25 as a chance. And here the M is set to 8. And that means how heavily do you weigh in the prior as compared to what you get out of your data. If M is very high, you say, okay, my prior feel is each letter out of four is equally likely, and I think that's very important to know. I'll put M to 20. Then you get another mix, then your data is doing less than here, right? So you can, with this sort of pseudo counting, you can set to what extent you weigh your preconceived notion into the data. Do you listen more to your data, or do you listen more to the idea you had before, right? That's how you can mix that in. Okay, pseudo counts. They're sometimes important, but I don't think in your exercise you need to go into that trouble. Okay, so I already told you we talked to a statistician, and that person already said immediately, okay, you need a model for your CPG islands, okay, but you need a null model. And so to represent the order. And then you can score the test sequence by taking, of course, the log of this one over the other. We've seen this for Dayhoff, for Blossom, for all of these things. This is a general way of dealing with things. Yeah? Take the log of the one model against the other. And now we'll put it into the Bayesian framework. That should mean the model for CPG islands the chance of, you know, I given x, this is the Bayesian formula I showed you a few times already, right? This was again the prior for your CPG islands, you need to know, I have a field there, and this is the same thing for your normal, you see that? Now, what are we going to do? And that comes in handily indeed, I think. You're going to take the ratio of these two models. Do you see something if you divide that by this? You don't need to worry about a few things anymore. The probability of x drops out. Ah, that saves us a bit of worrying. Good. And then people say, well, if you start disregarding anyway, you know, this prior, forget about it. So you can do that, and then you only have, of course, these two to compare. And that is what often happens. So people are, you know, playing with rigid statistical frameworks, first off, but then start forgetting half of it. In a way, you could say, is that still rigid? I leave that to you. But that is what happens a lot. So here, what will our model be? We have sequences, and hopefully we know a bit. We know about some islands. We can look how frequent these islands really are, and we would like to compare that to a sequence that has no island. You know, what do you expect? And what do you see if you really have a gene with a CPG island in front? How do these frequencies differ? Because in the end, you're learning from sequence. If you want to predict using a sequence, you should observe a difference between the thing you would like to see when it happens and when it doesn't happen. So you should see a difference between a gene region and a non-gene region. If there is no difference, you can't predict, right? So this is what people did, and I gave you some counts that were taken from data. And here you see this is the CPG. This is a set of sequences where they were known to have genes and CPG islands. And this was taken from a set of sequences that had no CPG islands. And you can probably see already, is that correct? Yeah, look at the likelihood of C followed by G. This is C followed by G here, this number. In the plus it's 27.7, so this is roughly four times higher. See that? And that means if you now use the formula with the, so there's this again. Ah, okay. Animation, I guess. Okay, same thing. So now we take the log, that was the formula, remember. If we do that, then we get this final model having this value. So this ratio, the log of that ratio of roughly 4, is a bit under 4, is roughly 2, the 2 log. So this is the number you get. And you see that this is what you expect to see. Yeah? And your model, and you can see that here, and here you have then your probabilities, your transition probabilities, going from any letter to another. If you see an A in the sequence that is followed by C, this is your probability. Yeah, and then you see this. So what happens, you basically, this model only says it doesn't care about the position of the CG. The moment it would see a C followed by a G, it would go through this probability, which of course is higher than the others. So if you have many CGs in a bit of sequence, the outcome will be higher than sequence without that. This is learned from the data. Yeah? So you have a set, an input set of sequences where you know things about, and you use that to set the parameters of your Markov model. Okay. So how could you use this? Now you have your Markov model. How could you use it in practice? A simple way of doing that might be to say, okay, how long is a CPG island? You say, well, I think a window of 100 long will give me something. So what do? You have your DNA sequence. You want to do your gene prediction. You take a window, take your first 100, you calculate, you go through the sequence, through your model, take these probabilities. If there are many CGs, the probability goes up. If not, it stays low. You shift by one, you do it again, you shift by one. And in the end, you could just get the scores over that whole genome sequence, and with a bit of luck, how would that plot look? Hopefully something like that. Oh, sorry again. I don't know, something like that, right? And then of course these regions would be supposed to be. And then you get these plots, and now of course the question becomes, if you have this, you know, where does really gene region start and where would it stop? How would you do that for this plot? That's another thing. And how do we, of course, you know, these questions are valid. You know, how do you select your length of the length of your window? CPG islands are known to have varying length, so how do you do that?
And also when you are at the end, when you're here in your window, at the end, so you will have a piece that is a CPG island, and a piece that is lower, that will have average statistics, so you might not pick it up. So what happens? Now, if you are worried about that, then there is another possibility now. And that is you make your model a little bit more complicated, because now you're going to say, you know what, I really make in my model, so far I had a model with just four states, four letters. Now I say, hold on, there can be a stretch of sequence in the CPG island, and you can be a stretch of sequence outside the CPG island, in a non-CPG island bit of the sequence, of the DNA sequence. So I make a model for CPG, and I make a model of not CPG, and then these are the transitions that you see here in between the CPG island. The G here is in the CPG island, it has a plus. If it will go over to this C, that would then mean it was the last one in the CPG island, and this one will be the first in the non-CPG part. So I'm going from yes to no. Right? So these are the transitions. As is written here, of course, behind here is a whole model, maybe with a begin state somewhere, the transitions in between, and here as well, but these are left out just for clarity. These are the transitions you would need to pinpoint the moment that your sequence goes over from the CPG island into a normal stretch, or from the normal stretch into the CPG island. Okay? These are these transitions. Okay? So that is also a way. And now basically, what type of model is this? Isn't this now a Markov model, or what do you know if you are somewhere in your sequence? An A can be here, or an A can be there. If you have your sequence, you don't know. So this is basically already a hidden Markov model, right? Because you don't know exactly how your pathway will be. If you don't know that, then it's hidden Markov. Okay? This is just one application for using CPG islands for a gene prediction using a hidden, in this case, a hidden Markov model, and before using a Markov model. Okay? Now, two things and then another example, then we're done. Should I speed up a lot? Well, a little bit. Okay, we go now to, so far we've done first order Markov models. You only remember the thing that happened before, not any earlier. Is that always a good idea? I give you an example. Yeah, so if we have a sequence again, a second order Markov model would say, okay, if I had in a state before I needed only to know about one letter, but if I go to a second order Markov model before the letter I observe, I worry about the two preceding letters, not one, the two, for the second order, and so on and so forth. Yeah, so you talk in fact about all possible dinucleotides in the past if you have a second order. Why would using more memory be good? Silly man's example, but I think it works. So if you have a higher model, you remember more history, if you like, right? What happened before. And additional history, if you have more a better picture of history, that might help you in making better predictions. For example, if you just have a list of words, and you have finish, and then, you know, the question is, you have the word finish, and up, it, first, last, and whatever should follow it. What should you pick? First finish it, finish up. But if you now know this, so the history is finished, what will be here? Given finish. Hard to say, right? First order Markov model. I make it the second order Markov model. Look at this. What is it? If this word is before it, fast guys finish what? Now you know what to fill. Finish up, it could be, but probably they finish first. Right? So, bit more history in this string helps you predict, set your probabilities better, okay? So that is the rationale for using more history. Does that happen in our business in bioinformatics? You bet, because for some reason, I'll tell you the reason in a moment, you see many of these models, and these are even fifth order Markov models. What do you see? The likelihood of the letter A in this bit of sequence depends on five letters before it. So what is that? For example, this one, five letters before this A is C, A, T, C, and in this case G. These are the five letters
before possible A. Yeah? So this A, the probability is dependent upon not just one letter before, but five. That's called the fifth order decoding. Okay? All together, you talk about six symbols. Now think about DNA, what are we talking about? If you have six letters, 2 times 3, two codons. It turns out that dipeptides in protein sequences, being that they're being encoded by two codons, is telling more than just another grouping of letters. So a lot of models for DNA are fifth order because they want to say something about dipeptides, meaning two codons in the DNA at the DNA level. Right? Okay, so that is how it works. So you see this a lot happening as well. Statistically, you think, how many of those will be in your database if you get more memory? You need to see really a string of 20 letters. How many will you find if you have an input set of sequences? If you count just A's or C's or T's, you find many. Yeah? If you have specific motifs like this, then you find fewer. A lot fewer, right? And that means, although this might be a good idea, using a data set to train it is more complicated. You have less data supporting it. And that's a bit of a problem. Do I have that already somewhere, I guess? But let's follow the slides. Okay, that's going into higher, into deeper memory, if you like. Another thing is, yeah, okay, I see you now. There is another trick you can use with Markov chains, with Markov models, if you like. They're called inhomogeneous. Now, there were questions earlier, what if I want the first bit, something else, then later bits, and then you can use these type of things. So you talk about different distributions. And one example of such an inhomogeneous Markov model is, for example, this one. And this signifies a codon, if you like. You know, we know that codon positions are different in terms of what you expect as a frequency, right? So if you know that, then a good model would be, I make a model like this, so I distinguish between the first position in a codon, the second, and the third. And you know, you can make it as complicated as you like. So this will be a Markov model for this, and that means that your distributions, the likelihood of seeing this letter C in the second position might be different than the likelihood of going through this C in the first position, right? And that's the inhomogeneous part. You distinguish in terms of likelihood between positions in this case in your sequence, because you know something about codons. Okay? You build it in your model, making it inhomogeneous. Is that a question or no? Okay, yeah, I saw some movement. Okay, now we combine these two, you can have an inhomogeneous Markov model with memory 5, fifth order. So this combined thing, position 1, 2, with a bit more memory. Many models for gene prediction have this form. Okay. So how should we select? Because I already told you a little bit of that problem. So we know it's maybe a good idea to use more history, as we saw, but the database should be large enough. What can you do if your database, you see an example here. A second order homogeneous Markov chain, if you mine the genome of E. coli, you would see every word too long 72 times on average, 72,000 times on average, oh, that's quite a lot, that's enough to count. But if you go to 8th order chain, for example, you only would see each occurrence 5 times on average, and that means if it's 5 on average, I bet there are a number of them you won't see at all, because there are many of them. So you have to do pseudo counting and all kinds of stuff if you want to. So there you see that, okay, this database apparently is not large enough to really go to an 8th order Markov model. So there is this trade-off between the advantage of using more memory with higher order models, but it's offset against the disadvantage of less reliable parameter estimation if you only see a few instances of the thing you want to see, right? Now you could say I want to, but maybe for some words I see very many in the database, and some other words I see few. Could you use this? And then the answer is yes, and then you use a so-called interpolated Markov model. Sorry, that's the last thing. In terms of, you have inhomogeneous, now you have interpolated. And that means Here, this is about the history. This is about the history one deep. This is about the history, I don't know, much deeper. What you're going to do, you're going to weigh, you're going to look in your data, and you say, hey, of this instance, I don't see very many. Oops, you know what? I go to less deep memory, because then I see more. Remember, dipeptide 72,000 times, an 8-mer only 5 times on average. You can sort of set these weights and bias these weights to those parts where you have lots of observations in your database. And of course, the total sum of the weights should be 1 to keep things in a probabilistic framework.
Do we have higher weights for deeper or?
Depending, if it's deep, deep is good, right?
Yeah.
But lots of data is good too.
Yeah.
So if you want to go deep but you don't see data, you say, oh, that's not good, I go less deep. Then I see more data.
Okay.
So you try to be as deep as possible, but it should be, and how do you do this? So I give you one example, one method that is using an ID to set these weights, okay? And that's the last thing for today. Maybe we can be reasonable in time. Let's try to do this. So, we can make the weights depend on the history, and but also on the data. Now, so we're going to do again gene finding using frequencies of letters, mining it from a sequence, so learning the parameters, and look at the frequency of letters in a certain gene region, and then predict is this a likely gene or is this not a gene. So all kinds of things in biology happen. We have different codons, right? Sometimes an amino acid is here, I think. Leucine is far more frequent, popular, okay, frequent than tryptophan in most genomes, tryptophan is the least. But leucine also has 6 different codons that encode leucine in the protein, and tryptophan is only one codon, right? So the moment one letter mutates in the tryptophan codon, it's not a tryptophan anymore. And if a mutation takes place in one codon for leucine, it might still code for leucine, right? So this is called, but some codons happen more frequently than others. And that is called codon preference. And this codon preference is vary a lot by species. And I think I've got an example about E. coli. Here, look. These are 4 codons that encode lysine as an amino acid. You see the last letter doesn't matter. But look at the frequencies. This hardly happens in E. coli, and this one happens a lot. And so it's not so that each codon for coding is equally likely. So that means, could you use this? Well, I would say, if I see this triplet, this tells me more about the likelihood of seeing a gene than when I see this codon, because it's very low of a gene, it might be a non-gene, right? So you start playing with it. Here you see all these numbers for a few other amino acids, the 2 codons for leucine, glutamate, and the 2 codons for aspartate. Yeah? You see, pretty different. And these differences, again, can be very different if you go to other species. So basically, very often these models, you need to train per species if these differences are really pronounced, okay? Depending on the situation. So basically what we're going to do is search by content. You know, you take basically these models take a stretch of sequence, they look at the frequency and say, oh, this is a likely gene, or probably not a gene. That's what we want to get at for this. Okay, so basically you train these models again, you know, using known open reading frames, so known gene areas, then you train, set the parameters, you know what to expect, you train the model, and then when you have set the parameters, you can use it to ask the same question to unknown sequences. Yeah? There is one model that's called GeneMAR by Borodovsky et al., and that is, again, as I said, very many in a fifth order. This is a fifth order inhomogeneous Markov chain, the one I showed you the picture of before. Yeah? Now, if you like bugs and so on and prokaryote genes, here's a lot of information. I gloss over it, you know. More is used. In our case, not even 1% is gene in our genomes. In bacteria, it's more than 90%, so there are differences. There's one other thing that is interesting. Upstream, a gene in prokaryotes, there is a little sequence that nearly always happens. So that's good help, right? Now we don't need to count CpG islands, you know, for prokaryotes. If you have this, then you know, you have a chance that following that is a gene. That's a good bit of help. Most models, of course, don't use it. Don't ask me why, but that's what you often see. Okay, so all kinds of stuff you can read at home. No time for me to really talk you through. So you have some early packages. I show you the picture and what are these things doing. If you are a gene, then your sequence, DNA sequence, should be segmented in codons, right? Do you know something about codon positions? What about the third codon? In what sense was that a bit special, third codon position? Do you remember? Most codons, doesn't matter what is there. We saw an example already, glycine. The third letter is very often free. So what do you expect to happen there? And now I tell you, DNA likes to become stable very often. You know how DNA does that, accumulating more C's and G's than A's or T's. What do you think you find in a gene region, I should say, in the third position? More C's, G's than you would expect in the other two positions, right? Because they're bound by the amino acid it needs to encode, right? So this is what these programs do. This is looking for GC bias in the third codon positions in stretches, and you see there's a typical thing coming out, sort of a rough thing like this, and this indicates a gene region. And this is the same thing, it turns out, connected to this, and that's all on this read at home slides, that if you have a third position there, you see that if there's more CG, the third codon positions tend to repeat more. It's another way of looking at the same thing, and you see that for the genome, there was the input here, you see that these two different methods, text coding, GC bias, are named the methods, you know, pinpoint the same gene region, right? So
how do you determine which part of the genome is the third codon?
You need to put your start somewhere, right?
Yeah.
So to you, if you're not sure, you start also at the neighbor and at the neighbor. The beauty is for prokaryotic genes there are no exons. So you start and you go to the end. The exons you have, how long is your exon? Also your intro. If that is not a multiple of three, you get a frame shift. There's another problem here. So these methods work, simple methods work well for bacteria, basically. Now, we go now back to the method I would like to end with. I will go a bit brief. So that program is called GLIMR. It's an interpolated Markov model. And it uses, so this is a model that says, okay, I would like to use as much history as possible, from 1 to 8 in this case. And if the data allows, I go to 8 deep. If the data doesn't allow, I go a bit less deep, because then I get more data. So I would like to use the data to, you know, squeeze out the most of the data in this sense. So this model, this program has, you know, there is something has been developed to do. So how does it work? So again, as I say, you need to train it, of course, by input sequences that are known gene sequences. That's always for a Markov model, you need to train it. And okay, and there is even a variant. So the method I'll discuss with you is for prokaryotes, for bacterial genomes. And there is now also one that is a bit more complicated for eukaryotic genes. So this method remained one of the giants in genomics, Salzburg. It's a bit old, but it still is used. So genes and material genomes. It's an inhomogeneous, eighth order interpolated Markov chain model, okay? Now, what's it doing? This looks, it first, as the first thing it says, okay, let's make this depth recursive. It sounds complicated, but it's in fact more straightforward than you might think. Here you see that with all the history you have the likelihood of something happening at position I, is dependent upon the letter before that, the letter before that, and so on and so forth. You class this in two ways, one term and one other term, and the only difference is you might see is this goes n deep in history, this one goes n less deep in history. Yeah? Hold on, am I saying that correctly? Yeah, n minus one is, this is one less deep. So, and you say, okay, I go to one less deep, and then you subdivide this one again, in this one in one less deep. So you have here the weight for n deep, the weight for n minus one deep, and that is here. N minus n deep is then the rest of possibilities, probability added to one, I minus n, and the other one I should say, is this one. So basically what this method is doing, they say, look, if I see 400 instances of one bit of sequence,
say 8 deep. Well, it will be good to see a stretch eight, a sequence bit of 8 long, more than 400 times. Then you say, then this program, these people say, that's enough for me. I use the full weight for that. So I go 8 deep. Could also be that you do not see something that is 400 deep. If it's less than 400, if you don't see it more than 400 times, you say, oh, I would like to use this memory, but I don't see enough data. I would have liked to see 400 instances. I see, let's say, 200 instances. Now I have to go to less deep memory. How much should I go back, let's say? Should I go to 8 or maybe 7 or even 6, you know, depending on how much you see. And that is done by all the time looking at the depth and then one less deep, and it says if the advantage, if I see a lot more when I go one step less deep in memory, you say, hey, that's a lot better. The data helps me far more here. I go one less in memory. Yeah, that's what this here wants to say. And a statistical thing is used, chi-square, goes over it, this is chi-square here. Basically, if there is a good difference between depth n and depth n minus 1, n minus 1 a lot better, more data, different, then it goes to that. And the formula it uses, and that's the last complicated thing I'll show you today, is here is for more, if you see a data element more than 400 times, you say, full weight, forget about the rest, I go to this depth, I don't need to look any less deep. If that is not the case, then you say, then this is used, this is how much better is D, sorry, it was on the last slide, is the statistical score of how different these two distributions are. If really one less deep gives you a lot more information than one more, one deeper in history, then you know you get a score out of that test in between 0 and 1 that is useful. And you see, if it's 200, you saw that you get D times 200 divided by 400. And that should score over 0.5. If that doesn't happen, then you just send it to 0. Meaning, my depth is not good enough, I don't look at it at all. So, it varies in between, I see enough data, I use it to the full, I don't see really enough for any depth, I use nothing here, and this is if you are somewhere in between. That's what this method is doing. And here are a couple of slides how people can brag about their methods. You all know this, I guess. These are performance tests, you've seen that. Basically what you do, if you predict a gene, it is really here, and you predict it to be here, then of course this is a false negative bit, and you don't predict it. You should have predicted it down. This is good, true positive, and here you predict a bit of gene while it's not there. So this is false positive, and this is you don't predict, which is correct. Okay? These four possibilities. Here are all kinds of measures to do this. Here's another one you might not have seen. That's used a lot, Markov. And here are the numbers, and these people brag that they're better. 9.1 to 9.7 is a big win, right? In the book of these people. And here also. You see here? Okay, guys, what does this mean? Sensitivity, so they predict better. They predict more gene sequences than the method they compare themselves against. But what happens here? What does this mean? PPV, remember what that was?
Precision?
No, it's positive predictive value. It means if you what you predict, how much was correct above the line in BLAST. What is above the line? The true positives, which you like, but also the false positives. If you get many false positives, look, then this goes down. Mm-hmm. So what does that mean if that PPV here is lower in the great method compared to the less? You overpredict. You say too easily, that's a gene. You have to be a bit more careful. Yeah? What is a useless method that has 100% coverage? Tell me. Give me the gene prediction method that has 100%. It always predicts all. You always say it's a gene. Fantastic. All the genes are predicted. But how do you pay? Of course, enormous amounts of false positives. Yeah? Okay, so. Don't worry, these are things in the sense that if all of this interpolated, you know, it's to show you that that can happen in your assignment, you don't need to do anything, okay? You go to the basic hidden Markov model, even a small one,
But we do that so that you really can understand, even you can do it by hand, and even in the afternoon you'll do something by hand on the hidden Markov model to just get a good feel of what it's all about. So, if this afternoon will be frustrating to you, I think it will be good fun, but suppose that, you know, 0.11% of the students might not like it, then after the lecture on Friday your world will be beautiful, I promise, okay? Hopefully. Okay, thanks, and sorry for taking 5 minutes of your time. Now I go here. Yeah, I do this.